So first answer your question three. I would have told him, don't do it. It's not going to work. As simple as that. But let me, Rajiv, take this opportunity to compliment, congratulate Professor Arun Kumar for having brought out the first comprehensive and researched book on the subject of demonetization. It has taken a while, but I think it's been worth waiting. And this, with facts and figures and arguments which are incontrovertible, proves one point very well, that 17 months down the line from the time demonetization took place, we can, without fear of contradiction, come to the conclusion that demonetization as an economic measure has failed comprehensively. It has, you know, every step has to be judged in the context of the goals it sets out to achieve. And in this particular case, as we are all aware, and Professor Arun Kumar has quoted this in his book, that in his November 8, 2016 speech, the Prime Minister says, and I quote, "So in this fight against corruption, black money, fake notes, and terrorism, in this movement for purifying the country," then he goes on to talk about the Mandarika also, "we are denotifying or abolishing the currency of rupees 500 and 1000 denomination notes." I felt particularly pain personally. And why did I feel personally pain? Because after the demonetization of 1978, I had brought back the rupees 1000 denomination note. So that was about, you know, and I felt as if my child has been killed. But apart from that personal hang, what do you do in order to clean up the system and start this Imandari also? You introduce rupees 2000 denomination. And so, corruption becomes difficult, terrorism becomes difficult, and the whole system is killed. And I not like to take your time on all the fantastic claims which were made by responsible people in government who had not even consulted about it, but were obliged to defend it. Those responsible people made fantastic claims that the stone throwing in the Valley of Kashmir had ended because of demonetization. In the recent election, or all the elections which have been held after demonetization in 2016, what has happened? Do we wash the notes in Mother Ganga before we take them to wherever they are supposed to go to purify them? And I entirely agree that in all the elections, as far as election expenditure is concerned, it has only increased, it has not diminished. And where is that money coming from? Where are electoral funds coming from? So So as Professor Arun Kumar said, you do not touch the source of black money or black income and deal with the symptoms, and naturally they will not work. They are bound to fail. Now, you know, my own feeling is, and it's based on some information also, that someone had told the Prime Minister that if he goes for demonetization, then something like 3 to 4 lakh rupees will not come back. And it will be a bonanza for the government. The government will suddenly become richer by 3 to 4 lakhs. But unfortunately that didn't happen. And the money has come back. Reserve Bank gave us weekly figures of the money which was coming back until what, 16 December. And then they stopped. And except for that figure of 98.8, they have not told us what is the final figure, not even the final provisional figure of the currency which has come back. Why? Because as Professor Arun Kumar was saying, maybe we have exceeded the currency in circulation, 15.44 lakhs on the day of demonetization, and we'll be thoroughly embarrassed if we were to admit that more currency has come back than was in circulation. People were even talking in terms of an amendment of the Reserve Bank of India Act to get hold of these 3-4 lakhs. And the government was hoping that they will take some populist steps, and much more than the success which we achieved in the UP Assembly election, all future elections will be ensured in favor of the ruling party. Now, to me it appears that we have not achieved a single of the objectives which were mentioned on 8 November. Digitization of the economy came later. It was not one of the original goals of the monetary. Poor people queued up. Not a single rich person stood in front of the bank. But we have always won the perception battle. And we won the perception battle thanks to sections of your fraternity. We won the perception battle because the poor felt it was in their hands. Now they know a little bit better.
Hello.
What has been the other side effect? Tax terrorism, which we used to criticize roundly when we were in opposition, has come back. 1.8 million cases have been started by the Income Tax Department. Is that department equipped to handle so many cases? And how much time it is going to take to bring those cases to a final conclusion? And we'll never know ultimately how much black money was actually captured as a result of this step until all those cases are settled. So it goes on and on, like the counting of notes by the Reserve Bank of India. It will never finish, not certainly not until the next Lok Sabha election. So that the perception of this having succeeded continues to hold. But Professor Arun Kumar talked about policy makers. It is not in the plural in this government. There is only one policy maker, and he decides what has to be done, and he decided that we will go for demonetization. As Rajdeep said, nobody else was consulted. We have had distinguished governors of Reserve Bank of India, former finance minister, saying that if this had happened in their tenure, they would have quit. This is the minimum that they should have done. But then we are living in a different age, and such small considerations don't matter anymore. So we continue in our course, and we continue to justify a decision to which we should have been a party, but we were not made a party. So, you don't need a long discussion on demonetization. As I said, with the passage of time, the only conclusion we can come to is that it has failed, and failed comprehensively. There was another potentate in the 16th century in Delhi who is been famous for shifting the capital from Delhi to Daulatabad. But we forget that he also had demonetized the currency in his time. He has gone back 5 centuries to repeat the mistake that gentleman, that king, made 5 centuries.
So basically you are saying Narendra Modi is Mohammed bin Tughlaq. You didn't take the name, but you said enough. But I think, barring Jai, there is a general consensus here that demonetization hasn't reduced corruption. I think November 8, that was the primary focus of the Prime Minister's speech. He spoke of purifying society. So, Professor Arun Kumar, if demonetization has failed to reduce corruption, what would have succeeded? Let's be very clear. Elections in particular, we'll ask our politicians whether they believe money has actually reduced in elections. Jay Panda says in land transactions, in private colleges, it has had some kind of a positive impact. But clearly on elections, anecdotal evidence seems to suggest it has had very limited impact, particularly for the ruling party. If anything, what has happened is there is an imbalance today between the funds available to the ruling party and the funds available to the opposition. But if you then had to suggest what would have actually reduced corruption, your book suggests demonetization hasn't done the job. What would? Would it have been stronger, more transparent attempts at election funding, at regularizing the manner in which funds are distributed in elections? Should that have been the first step rather than demonetization? We'll open it up to the audience in about 15 minutes.
As I said earlier, maybe at least 40 committees and commissions that have gone into different aspects of black economy in the last 70 years. Starting in 1948, that was the first committee. We had Sardhanam Committee, Dagli Committee, and various other committees. We made thousands of suggestions. So it's not a technical problem. We've taken hundreds of steps. Because it's not the first time we've taken a step. As I said, we've done voluntary disclosure schemes, we've done bearer bond, acquisition of undervalued property because real estate is supposed to have a lot of black money, etc. So the point is, what is the real cause? The real cause lies in the politics. Because then black economy is 62% of GDP according to my estimate. It means 62% of economic activity has illegality. Now how can illegality be so large? So I argue that it's systematic and systemic. So the black economy works as a system just like the white economy works as a system. And the policymaker, the executive and the businessmen are party to it. So there's a triad which runs the black economy. This triad has to be broken. How to break the triad? Through accountability. So when accountability comes to the public, whether the businessman, whether the politician, or whether the executive, until that accountability comes, you're not going to solve the problem. And look at, say, other countries like Britain of 1810, 1820, 1830, there are a very similar thing of corruption there as here. You know, you look at USA, corporate calls Rockefeller, Ford, and Carnegie Mellon as Robert Barron because they used to float companies and sink them, you know. So how did they solve it? Through movement, through accountability. You know, Watergate is a minor theft, but you know, the president had to resign because he had reported a lie. In the UK, you have, you know, House of Lords members who pledge 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 pounds to get something done in the House. They get caught and they have to resign. So in a sense, public accountability is the key. So therefore, political movements must be supplemented with consciousness change through other political and social movements. Unless political and social movements are strong, they will not be able to check the political process, etc. And therefore, it's not just election financing. Election financing is only 0.1% of the black economy. Okay, but it's the nexus that gets formed at the time of election that's the crucial thing. So it's not so much how much money. Even if suppose you take 5 crore per constituency or 10 crore per constituency, that only adds up to 0.1% of the black economy of that year. So it's not the black economy, it's a huge part is being used in elections, but it's the nexus formation and that triad that gets created, that needs to be broken. That's been my solution. So in the long run, unless that political change comes, the social change comes, we're not going to solve the problem.